Hi everyone, this is Matthew Ness doing an 8-man with Standard Elves. It's my first video, so bear with me a little bit. I also have a bit of a cold, so you might be able to hear that. Just going over the deck real quickly. I've changed it up a tiny bit. It's mostly tuned at this point. I'm currently at 19 lands, only 3 of which are Ornreach. They became a little bit clunky, and so I've decided that 3 is the right number. It's still, I wouldn't go to 2. I think between 3 and 4 is pretty close. As far as other counts, all the mana dudes are clearly 4 ofs. Drago Warcaller has been really impressive and is definitely a 4 of. Carporn Scout has moved around a little bit. I like it at 1 right now since I do, believe it or not, tutor for it with Fauna Shaman from time to time. But it's not great in multiples and it gets boarded out against decks with sweepers since it encourages overcommitting. I've moved the Nissa package to the main, as you can see here, but I'm currently only playing 2 Chosen and 2 Ravain. That hasn't really been a problem, since most of the time you don't get to activate the Nissa's plus abilities multiple times, or if you do, a Chosen will die somewhere, or they'll just be winning so badly that it won't matter. So I like the 2 and 2 count. Playing more than 2 Chosens is frustrating since you draw them too much. And playing more than 2 Nissas is clunky. Playing more than 2 Ravains is clunky. The Azuri count is currently at 3. It could easily be at 4. Azuri is one of the most powerful cards in the deck, but since I have 4 Fauna Shamans to find it, I found that 3 is relatively reasonable. And since there's less Carporn Scouts in the deck now, only one, one of Azuri's big pluses is that it's so good with Carporn Scouts. So when the Carporn count went down, the Azuri count did as well. The Leatherback Baloth is mainly a concession to curve. It's kind of, I guess you could say, instead of the fourth Azuri. It's kind of okay against everything. Doesn't have a whole lot of synergy with the deck, but it is efficient, and this deck has 8 ways to play it on turn 2, so it's quite strong. But it could easily be cut. I'm just not exactly sure what I'd want in its place. The four Vengevines, that count has sometimes been at 3, but I like having 4 to pitch to Fauna Shaman so that every game, or at least a significant portion of the time when you draw Fauna Shaman, you immediately have a Vengevine to pitch, as opposed to having to tutor for a Vengevine with your first Fauna Shaman activation before getting the engine going. The Nissa Ravain count, as I said, is at 2. The Garruk count is at 2 because if you're playing too many high-end spells, you run into trouble. So I like the Garruk and Monument count at 2 and 2, since I'd definitely rather draw one of each than two of either one. And so that count feels right to me. The sideboard, the four Tectonic Edges have been great. I've gone as far as considering moving some number of them to the main, but I certainly like having 4 in the 75. The Nature's Claims are basically just for the Quest for the Holy Relic deck. They're not bad against Boros either, but they're mainly there because the sideboard of this deck in general is pretty weak. But it's just a nice card to have, kind of a Kind of, it's so good against the Quest for the Holy Relic deck that even though that deck's unpopular, it just adds so much value to that matchup that it seems worth it. Leyline of Vitalities come in against both aggro and decks with Pyroclasm. If you play a Leyline and then play like a turn 1 Llanowar Elves followed by a turn 2 Archdruid, that blanks Pyroclasm completely, and that's really powerful. And against something like Vampires, it makes combat much in your favor with the extra 1 toughness to all your creatures, and gains you life to get out of Highborn burn range, or if they're playing the red version, normal burn range. The extra Garruk in the board comes in against a lot of decks. It's mainly just for when you have stuff you want to board out, since it's kind of decent against everything. The Autumn's Veils are against blue control decks. I'm not as huge a fan of them as I once was because I found out they actually can't counter Jace Bouncing. If you read the card, it says creatures you control can't be the target of blue or black spells this turn. They can be the target of blue or black abilities, unfortunately. So once I found that out, their stock has gone down a little bit, but for now I'm still leaving them in the deck to give them a try. They're still good for forcing through monuments and planeswalkers, which are huge in the control matchups. And so if you can just play one of those with one mana up when they go to Mana Leak or Stoic Rebuttal it, you can just get them right back, and once one of those resolves, the game's usually over. The Acidic Slime is a Fauna Shamanable answer to artifacts and enchantments. It's again for the just like Nature's Claim for the Boros and Quest for the Holy Relic matchups. And that's the deck, and I'll see you back soon once the round starts. Alright, so our round just started. We lost the roll, our opponent chose to play, and mulliganed his opening hand. Our hand is a little awkward in that it's light on gas, but I still think it's a keeper. Even though it doesn't have a real, like, planeswalker or monument or something like that, casting two archdruids and a bunch of elves is a pretty formidable offense. Leading with a mountain and saying go probably means he's on Volokut ramp. The Arbor Elf's definitely better than Tree Speaker here since we want to cast the turn two archdruid. I would not be surprised if he had the bolt for our archdruid, but I don't really see, it's kind of tough to make an argument for casting two elves instead of the archdruid here. Just gotta cross our fingers. And he had the bolt, unfortunately. It's not a big deal, but he could have, in theory, played the mountain that he got with Cultivate instead of playing the mountain from his hand, and one could argue it'd be marginally better. And he had the second bolt, which is frustrating. Now, we have to decide whether Arbor Elf or Tree Speaker is better. I think the answer is Arbor Elf, since if we draw a 4-drop, we can play it and both Tree Speakers, and the long-term mana won't be very useful. It won't be very relevant, I should say. And another Cultivate from him means he doesn't have a Primeval Titan in hand, which is certainly a good sign. We can hope that he's just very flooded. Fauna Shaman's an interesting draw. It means we certainly want to keep one creature in our hand. I don't really see a purpose to keeping two, although it's a tough call. I think I am going to save the Tree Speaker, since the one damage is likely irrelevant and the mana is almost certainly irrelevant, so I think I'm just going to save both cards in our hand. That's tough to justify. I'm certainly playing the Fauna Shaman. It's unclear if I'm going to go for anything else. I think at this point I'm going to also play a Tree Speaker, but I'm not going to level it because I think the damage is worth more. That's also a tough call. I think I actually am going to level it. I'm going to level it. These are very marginal decisions, but in the end, considering that I have a Fauna Shaman to use next turn, I could easily have a lot of mana sinking to do. I'm not exactly sure what my plan for killing him is this game. An Avenger of Zendikar for him is certainly going to make it harder. And he has the fetch, so we're now on a very quick clock. We absolutely could use an Eldrazi Monument, but other than that, Azuri is a pretty decent way to get past Avenger, and Warcaller will certainly help. So now we can play Azuri and a Warcaller for one, which is not going to necessarily get by his army, but could at least give us a hand. I think that's the line I'm going to go with. Because I can't really think of anything better. We're actually not in terrible shape this game, as we can use the Azuri to regenerate at least one of our creatures, and if he attacks for too much, he could easily die on the backswing. It partially depends on how many times he can trigger the Avenger of Zendikar with his hand. If it's only once, then we're certainly not dead, but if it's a lot more than that, then we could be in trouble. into Summoning Trap is a bit scary. If he whiffs on this, we're not in terrible shape. And Oracle. If he whiffs on this Oracle, fingers crossed here. Alright, so we're certainly going to want to kill him on the following turn, or else things are going to get very ugly very fast. You want to do some quick math here to get a sense of what we're going to need to live. I guess we'll wait for next turn since there's no real decisions to be made here. We have enough guys that we could easily block a significant portion of his plant army. The problem is the Titan's going to give him two more landfall triggers on the next turn and give him a lightning bolt if he gets Volokut in a mountain. And then he'll be able to have multiple looks with Oracle of Moldiah that could easily give him more triggers. So it's going to be tough if this game goes another turn. If we draw an Eldrazi Monument, we may just be able to come over the top for the kill. 3, 7, 10, 14, 17 or so. Might be a little bit short there. The Nissa Ravine. The Nissa will allow us to gain some life. However, that's not necessarily overly exciting. Swinging with the team here is almost certainly going to go badly for us. So I think not exactly sure what our plan should be here. We could definitely get Anissa's Chosen, but I don't think that would really accomplish anything. As they would just make one more blocker, which wouldn't be as relevant as gaining 12 life. Yep, I'm going to play the Ravine and gain 12. Or, if I do get a Chosen, the one nice thing is it could allow me to... It could allow Eldrazi Monument to be an out, which is promising. I think I actually am going to get a Chosen. If we had a Copperhorn Scout instead of one of the other one-drop creatures, we might actually be able to kill him this game, because we could overrun multiple times. But unfortunately, that's not the case. And he had a land off his Oracle, apparently, and a second one. That is going to be too much to beat, I fear. Because every... Now he's playing the Primeval Titan instead of using his second land drop, which I'm not sure I agree with, but I don't think it's going to matter. And he got double Volokut instead of Volokut Mountain, which could buy us an extra turn. Because he could have bolted a blocker if he'd gotten Volokut Mountain. But we'll see. We can regenerate from his attack, so I'm not overly worried. If his goal is to kill us, that's one thing. And it looks like he may give us one more turn to draw a monument. That is very convenient. And fingers crossed here. And that is not an Eldrazi Monument. So we can overrun an attack with the team. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 guys. He has 7 plants though, and those are all going to be 6, 7. So don't think we're going to make him play it out from here. We're just going to pack it in. Now against the ramp decks... My plan is, I don't love Tech Edge against the ramp decks, but I usually bring it in just out of necessity, since it's still better than some of the other cards. I like a couple ley lines to protect Pyroclasm, but you don't want too many since they obviously aren't actually good in the matchup. They don't really have any impact. I hate the Nissa package. And Oran Reef is not bad for protecting Pyroclasm, but I feel like Tech Edge is the better non-basic still. I like to leave in some amount of War Callers, even though I'm taking out the Oran Reef, so I'm going to bring them out for now and just get a sense. If we want two Ley Lines, the Garruk, and two Tech Edges, we could just take it in all four Tech Edges and not leave in a single War Caller, which might be a reasonable... Or we still have room for four War Callers, excuse me. That might be a reasonable line, since War Caller is pretty powerful against them, and our plan is kind of to get a Ley Line out and then get a Lord out.